no good, James. I just can't tell. We could be approaching America for all I know. Thoughts some life from out here.
It's just that you're seeing things from a different point of view.
Sometimes that's no bad thing. I've enjoyed this trip.
Oh, Liverpool to Swansea back. Hardly gives you a taste of blue water. Still, it's a start. Well, what do you reckon, Baines?
Well, I was right. Compass is definitely off. What was she carrying before? Steel plates?
Right. Swansea to Belfast. Regular run.
That is why it's definitely overcompensated.
There's plenty of fixed bearings around.
All right, we could swing the compass here or wait till we get back. It's up to you, sir.
Well, what do you say, Letty?
Well, I say the pair of you are talking double Dutch. I haven't understood a word.
Oh, it does sound a bit like gibberish, doesn't it? Come on. Luke, now, the ship's been carrying a lot of metal. Now metal affects a compass.
You mean it doesn't give a true reading?
Right. So inside there, they put magnets to correct the error.
But now that you've no longer got a cargo of metal, the compass is all wrong again. Is that what you mean?
By heck, we'll make a sailor of her yet, babes.
There's a sheltered cove a little way out the coast. I mean, we can anchor there for the night.
Right. Why not?
Good. That means for once I can have supper without chasing my plate all over the table.
And as it's your last night aboard, man, I'll tell the cook to come up with something special.
Thank you, Captain Baines.
What do you think of the Falcon?
Pretty name for a pretty ship.
Pretty? She's a workhorse.
Well, can't a workhorse be pretty?
Right. You're in a funny mood.
Well, that's just the sea air.
Well, I'm sorry to have kept you waiting, Sir Norman.
Not to worry, Daniel. I was a trifle early anyway.
Ah. Elizabeth will be down immediately. Let me get you a drink.
Thank you. I've just been reading about that robbery in Manchester. In broad daylight, if you please.
Yes, I saw. £50,000. Mm. That's not the only daylight robbery that's going on.
Oh? How do you mean?
Well, these new freight charges on the railway. Do you realize, Norman, that mile for mile, the line between Liverpool and Manchester is the highest price in the entire country?
I know. And believe me, I've drawn the attention of the House to it. And to this handling charge of 8 shillings a ton.
Between them, the Mersey Docks and Harbour Board and the railways have a complete monopoly. Damn it, they're holding Manchester to ransom.
And since you've just acquired a mill there, you'll have to use the railway to bring in your raw cotton.
Well, yes, I admit to a degree of self-interest, but only a degree. Even without the mill, I'd be against these new freight rates and handling charges on principle.
Well, as I neither represent Liverpool nor Manchester, perhaps I could lobby support as a disinterested party.
I'd hoped you might.
But I do advise you to think of an alternative solution.
Well, there is no alternative.
Believe me, Daniel, speaking as a politician, there is always an alternative.
Oh, yes, horse and car. So you feel the government will do nothing?
Well, you must remember the railways are private companies. You wouldn't want the government telling you how to run your business, would you? We don't do things like that in this country, thank God. Now you take this foreign fellow who's just died, Karl Marx. Ever read his book?
No, never even heard of him.
Every single page of that book preaches one thing. Complete anarchy.
Not in Liverpool, I trust.
My dear Lady Fogarty, by heck, Daniel, you're a lucky chap to own such a wife.
Daniel doesn't own me, Sir Norman.
What? Well, I mean, still he has the pleasure of your company.
Thank you. What was all this talk of anarchy?
Just a business matter, ma'am. But when beauty walks in through the door, then dull business must needs fly out the window.
I'm so sorry you were not able to bring Lady Truscott.
Another slice of plum love, ma'am.
Oh, thank you, Captain Baines, as much as I liked it.
I'll tell Long Charlie whose plum love is his speciality. Well, if you'll excuse me, ma'am, I'll take a turn on deck, see that everything's snugged down for the night.
I might join you there later, Baines.
All right, you are, sir.
You know, in a way, I'm quite looking forward to going home tomorrow.
Aye. Landfalls and departures.
Leaving home, coming home, beginnings and endings. All chapters in a sailor's life.
Well, go on.
Hmm?
Well, it's not often I hear you talk about the sea.
Well, not much to say. Not in words. Wonder how Sarah's faring.
Probably a bad idea to have to turn around to supper. Mm. Right. Get her out of that house. Thank goodness she's got Samuel. Must be a comfort for a woman, having a son like that.
He was a good lad. Got his head screwed on. He'll carry on Robert's name.
You miss him, don't you?
Robert? Pompous old fool? I do. Oh, a bit stuffy in here. I think I'll go on deck. Finish my cigar.
Don't be long. Oh, if there's one thing I cannot bear, it's being treated like some idiot child to whom business and politics is a foreign language.
So I've observed.
Why did you invite him to dinner in the first place?
Well, I'd hope to enlist his help in the House of Commons over these new railway freight charges.
Perhaps if you'd asked my advice first before buying that mill in Manchester.
Elizabeth. Anyway, it seems there's nothing I can do but pay up.
What about the old canal?
What?
The Bridgewater Canal runs between Liverpool and Manchester. It was there long before the railways.
No, no, no. Barges drawn by horses would take too long. Now, wait a minute. Suppose they were towed by a steam tug. Now, Elizabeth, I believe you found the answer.
Oh, Daniel, surely not. A mere woman.
No, yes, yes, yes. I must check on the depth and may need widening in places.
Are you going to be planning and scheming all night?
Now, I wonder how long it would take a steam tug to... I'm sorry, what did you say?
Well, we could talk about this in bed.
Oh, yes, yes, perhaps we could.
Good night, Baines. Good night, sir.
Thought you'd be asleep.
It's a bit tired. Mm-hmm. Beautiful night.
Full moon tonight. See, you don't catch cold in that thing.
I won't. Not if you put your arms around me.
Damn it, Sir Daniel, I've got a train to catch.
And so you shall. Now, just give me 10 minutes.
Oh, very well. Lady Fogarty not about?
No, she's at the yard. I was on my way there myself when the idea struck me, and I knew I had to see you at once. Norman, I've found a way to break those freight charges.
Oh?
There you are. Been sitting under our noses all the time. The old canal.
Barges?
Oh, that was my first thought. To tow them by steam tug to Manchester.
Steam tugs? Now, that's a good thought.
Yeah, but not to tow barges. Oh, that would mean unloading and loading both at Liverpool and Manchester.
Well, that's what the railways do.
Yes, but we can do better. We'll take the ships all the way to Manchester.
Ocean-going steamers on that tuppenny halfpenny bit of water?
Yes, but we'll enlarge it. We'll make it wider and make it deeper. We'll start here at Latchford.
Latchford? Well, yes, I suppose it could be done. But think of the cost.
Think of the return, and think of the demand. A port in the heart of one of the biggest manufacturing areas in the country. Now, you cut transport costs, you cut the price of goods.
Of course, an idea like that would benefit the whole country. That sort of thinking might get government support.
And if the railways want to stay in business, they'll have to bring their charges down. They'll have to compete.
You do realize you'll have to get a bill through the House to build a canal like that?
Yes, I do. And no doubt there'll be a lot of opposition. But in the meantime, if you could take a few soundings...
Discreetly, of course.
I thought I heard the carriage return.
Miss Uncle James and Aunt Letty have returned. I wanted to show her the sales figures for the parcel post. Ah, here they are. You're going out, Mother?
Yes. It's high time I was back to my committee work. I thought it might help take my mind off.
Ah, yes, yes. I was in the store this morning. They told me you'd been there yesterday.
Yes. I summoned up the courage to go into your father's office. I could only bear it for a few minutes. It's as if he was...
Yes, well, it is a little soon.
Samuel, I don't think I ever want to go back into the store again.
Well, there's no reason why you should, Mother. It's more or less running itself.
You're only saying that because you want to spend all your time developing that parcel post idea of yours.
Yes, it was Father's idea as well, Mother.
As a subsidiary. Now, even from the short time that I was there yesterday, it was quite clear to me that that store is not running as efficiently as your father would have liked.
Then I suppose I shall have to give it more time.
No.
What?
Your heart wouldn't be in it. You've made that quite plain.
You're surely not suggesting I sell it?
Indeed I am not. No, we must appoint a manager.
Mother, if you remember, I did suggest...
I know you did, and at quite the wrong time.
Oh, now it's the right time.
Oh, yes. Properly managed, that store will be a lasting memorial to your father's good name.
Capital. In that case, as I see it, there's only one possible choice.
I quite agree.
Mr. Fitch.
Fitch? He's only a boy.
He's at least 30. But more important, he has ideas.
Yes, above his station. Now, Mr. Denton's been with us for years.
Mother... The store is under my control.
Very well. Appoint Fitch, if you insist, but I think you're making a mistake. Now, I must be off to my committee work.
Yeah, but I was hoping to use the carriage.
Ah, but you see, Samuel, the carriage is under my control. I'll drop you off somewhere, if you like.
Hello, Mr. Fraser.
Oh, Mr. Avery.
Not looking for cargo, are you?
Why? What do you have?
Well, I was merely here. I could perhaps find you a parked cargo.
I see. Perhaps, isn't it? Mr. Dunwoody? Excuse me.
Coming, sir.
Good day, Uncle.
Who are you?
Avery, that parked cargo you mentioned...
Doesn't exist, Mr. O'Needham. Things are all back to front these days. It's getting hard for a man to turn a decent penny. Heard you've just acquired another ship.
Ah, the Falcon. We berthed this morning.
Happen you'll be wishing she'd fly away. Mm. It's been a quiet month. Steamer, is she?
No, two-masted ketch.
You'll never make her pay. Should have gone over to steam long ago. And mark you, even the steamers have found it pretty hard this last month.
Not Fraser's, eh?
No, and I'll tell you why. He cuts his rates to the bone. He's put all his crews on half pay, masters included. Well, when a man's got a family to feed, he'll damn nearly work for nought. And if Frasers drive other lines to the wall, well... Now, I can't say I like that nephew of yours, but I must admit I admire him.
Well, luckily, most of my ships are on the grain and night run. But I am looking for some short-haul work, for the Falcon, you know, coastal work.
You're too grand to carry coal these days, Mr. O'Needham?
No, I'll carry coal, anything you can find. I don't like an idle ship.
No more than most of these.
Oh, I'll make it worth your while. Well, see what you can do, huh?
Hello, George.
Well, I'll be damned, Jack Wadham. How did you...
I'm still a member.
I thought that you...
That they'd struck me off. Drummed me out of the regiment. You've got a poor memory, George. Nothing was ever proved, was it? Oh, I know. Jack Wadham was a naughty boy. But like a true friend, you put your hand in your pocket and helped me out. A man doesn't forget his friends, George.
Good, good. What are you doing now?
Oh, general business mainly. I'm also agent for one or two notable companies and help to run the estates of several quite distinguished gentlemen. Wouldn't do to name names, of course.
No, I understand.
Now, I don't know if you can help me, George, but I want to charter a ship.
Of course, Jack. Anything to help an old friend.
The very reason I came straight to you.
How much cargo have you got?
Very little.
Oh, so it's only a part cargo.
You weren't listening, George. I said I wanted to charter a ship. Short run to Ireland.
Steamers don't come cheap, Jack.
Don't want a steamer. Small sailing vessel will do. Something that won't attract too much attention. And I want a captain who can make a fast passage.
What tack are you on?
Just find me the ship, George, then we'll talk business.
I shall have to know the cargo.
Half a dozen bales of cloth.
What's it made of, gold thread?
You always were a bit of a wag, George.
No, seriously, Jack, I shall have to know.
Oh, of course you will. Just don't want it banded about, that's all.
Well, I'll tell you this, Samuel. I'm going to have to pull my socks up, otherwise your auntie will buy me out lock, stock and barrel. Right, well, then I'll get back to the exchange.
Sir, I was wondering...
Speak up, lad.
Yes, sir. Mr. Irving and his company are playing here tonight, sir, before they set sail for America. Mm-hmm. And I rather hoped you might give me
you
your
want
permission
to take Charlotte to the theatre, eh?
Yes, sir.
Of course, she hasn't been out of the house for a week, James.
Well, I'm not objecting, am I?
Oh, thank you, Father.
Ah, see that you come straight back home afterwards.
Of course.
Right.
Oh, I'll
be off.
See you to the door.
I've never known him in such a good mood.
Aye.
Samuel, I've just had a marvellous idea.
Oh, what?
Why don't we invite William to come along with us?
Yes.
If you want to know the truth of it, Daniel, I think you have gone completely mad. Yes, I am well aware that luncheon is ready.
We won't be long, Mary.
After this news, I doubt I could eat a thing.
Elizabeth, it was partly your idea.
Never. Steam tugs towing barges, I can perhaps see the sense in that. But ocean-going cargo boats steaming all the way to Manchester? Have you considered the effect it would have on Liverpool?
Oh, certainly I have. It'll increase trade.
I fail to see how. If you have your way, ships will no longer dock in Liverpool at all. They'll all pass straight through to Manchester, and it'll be that city that reaps the profit.
Well, not if the Harbour Board and the railways make their terms more attractive.
What you're proposing is the ruination of Liverpool.
But that is nonsense.
Well, I won't be party to it. Neither will I stand idly by and see it happen.
Elizabeth, surely it was our intention to be partners in everything.
Not this. I was born and bred in Liverpool. I've spent all my life in this city. Now, I know the same doesn't apply to you. So I suggest that while you have your lunch on your own, you may consider where your allegiance really does lie.
I asked not to be disturbed today.
Oh, yes, but it was a deputation.
A deputation, Mr. Dunwoody?
Of the captain's, yes, sir. Well, they particularly asked that I see you today. Although they stress the point that they in no way intend to go on strike.
I should hope not, indeed. There's enough of that nonsense going on across the river.
Well, will you see them, sir?
No. No, there's little point in discussing something I can do nothing about. As soon as trade improves, so are their wages.
And I'm to tell them that, am I, sir?
You can tell them that I can employ half the fleet on full pay, or the whole fleet on half pay.
Well, put that way, sir, I'm sure they'll understand.
There are many lines with ships lying idle. I hear old Murchison's even thinking of selling up.
So I believe, sir. Great pity. He's a fine gentleman. Mm.
Oh, hello.
Oh, may we come in for a moment, William?
Yes, of course.
Oh, Mr. Dunwoody.
Charlotte.
William. Mr. Dunwoody.
Mr. Samuel.
Thank you, Mr. Dunwoody. How are you, Samuel? Is business going well?
Oh, very well indeed, yes. As a matter of fact, we've expanded
business,
further
business.
Than
business. William, Samuel has something to ask you.
Oh?
Yes, Charlotte and I are going to the theatre tonight.
To see Henry Irving? Yeah.
And we wondered if you'd care to come along.
Well, it's very kind of you, Samuel.
Oh, it was Charlotte's idea, really.
But you agreed. Anyway, will you come, William?
I'd like to very much, but I've got so much work to do.
Oh, surely you can leave it for one night.
No. No, I'm afraid I can't.
Oh, I see. Then you don't mind Samuel taking me to the theatre on his own?
Not at all. I think it's very kind of him.
What ship would you use?
Well, the Falcon. She's small but fast.
And the master? Need an experienced captain?
In that case, I suggest Captain Baines. Now, tell me, you want to charter a ship just for half a dozen bales of cloth?
Yes, that's right, isn't it, Mr. Waterford?
The point is, sir, are you interested? Well, I wouldn't be standing here if I wasn't, but I'd want to know a sight more than I've got out of Avery there.
All right. Ever heard of Colonel Sir Patrick McGeary?
No.
He's an Irish gentleman. Has an estate just north of Dublin, another one not far from here in Lancashire. Now, Sir Patrick is a man of considerable wealth, and also something of an eccentric. Suddenly, he's decided that he wishes to move all the family heirlooms back to Ireland.
Why?
Perhaps as a sign that in these troubled times, his heart lies with the Irish cause.
A short while ago, the Fenians tried to blow up the town hall. Perhaps that's what's worried him.
He may, of course, have totally different reasons. I'm merely his agent.
And, well, it sounds simple enough, sir. So if you get all your bits and pieces together, insured and delivered to my ship.
No.
What do you mean, no?
Sir Patrick has told me quite plainly that he has no wish to advise others of what he might be doing. After all, it's an extremely valuable cargo. Only it so happens that, luckily, Both his estates are on the coast. So you will simply anchor off, and the cargo will be rowed out to you. And in Ireland, the reverse will happen.
Mm-hmm. Hardly be need for bills of lading at all.
I don't know. If a customs officer were to board me, I could be accused of smuggling.
Smuggling? Mm-hmm. My dear fellow, Sir Patrick is merely transferring his own property from one part of the British Isles to another.
As you say, it is a valuable cargo, and you're asking for a deal of discretion.
For which Sir Patrick is prepared to pay, handsomely.
Well, then, let us come to terms, eh?
Very well.
£1,000, I think.
That's a lot of money, Mr. O'Needham.
It's a deal of discretion, Mr. Wallam. £1,000.
I'll attend to the details immediately.
Seems almost eager to part with Sir Patrick's money.
Jarvis, pistol.
Do be seated.
Forgive me for calling on you unannounced, Mr. Pilgrim.
My door is always open to those who need me. Now, how can I help you?
First of all, let me introduce myself. My name
Please, I would rather you didn't tell me your name. Names conjure up false images.
Oh, I see.
In fact, the less I know about you, the better. Now, what brought you to my door?
A lady I know. When she heard that... Oh, dear, there are some things I must tell you.
When this lady heard that you were recently widowed...
How did you know?
You are still in mourning.
Oh, yes, of course. This lady said, go and see Inigo Pilgrim. He will help you. So here I am.
And here I am. Ready to help you.
It says outside, Chapel of the Spirit. Does that mean we're on hallowed ground?
Surely all ground is hallowed.
What I meant is this a consecrated place of worship?
I do not hold services, if that is what you mean.
What exactly do you do, Mr. Pilgrim?
I am merely an instrument. I have been given a gift and can talk with those who have passed over.
Passed over?
You would call them the dead.
Oh.
It is only ignorance that makes us fear the unknown. Children fear the dark. But when they understand the meaning of light, there is no fear.
You say that you can talk with those who've passed?
Yes.
Would I be able to hear them?
No, they talk through me. I pass on their messages. Sometimes they are simply words of endearment or comfort. But on occasion, they can offer a great deal of advice. Being on the other side, they can, of course, see both past and future.
Mr. Pilgrim, how would one go about...
Wait. Give me your hand. Good news, Sarah. Robert has a message for you. First of all, he says that you should not be afraid and that you should trust in me. He also said that you should not worry about these decisions that you have to make. And finally, he said that the choice that you made today was the right one.
The choice? You mean about coming here?
No, I believe it was to do with something else. You'll forgive me now, Sarah, but I must rest and recover my strength.
Yes. Yes, of course. Mr. Pilgrim,
You've given me such hope. May I come again?
Next time, I shall be more prepared for your visit. Perhaps Robert will have more to say.
You think so?
It's possible.
Sarah, you weren't taken in by him, surely?
Letty, I tried to tell him my name, but he stopped me. And then later, without a moment's hesitation, he called me Sarah, and then went on to mention Robert by name. Now, how do you explain that?
Sarah, the Enidid family are not exactly unknown in Liverpool.
Oh, James and Elizabeth, perhaps.
And Robert? He was a public figure. And though you may not realise it, Sarah, so are you. Well, think of all the committees you serve on. Well, there must be thousands of people who know you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, perhaps you're right, but it was his manner that... I could almost believe that... No, I did believe that Robert was actually speaking to him.
Because you wanted to believe.
Yeah, well, suppose that's true.
Well, of course it is. Men like that, they prey upon the sorrows of others. He ought to be locked up.
Letty, how did he know about the decisions I have to make?
Well, any woman who's been recently widowed has decisions to make. There's nothing remarkable in making a statement like that. Oh, I'm sorry, Sarah, but... Well, it's obvious to me that the man's a fraud.
Oh, Letty, I think you're being a bit hard on him. He lives in quite humble circumstances, and not once did he bring up the subject of money.
Oh, he will. That is, if you're foolish enough to return.
Well, he did say that next time he might have more information for me.
And I warrant at this very moment he's finding out all he can about Robert and Sarah O'Needin.
Yes, well, perhaps you're right. I'll sleep on it.
So, the captains are willing to see reason?
Oh, yes, sir. It was a long meeting. It took some time for me to convince them that your solution was equitable to all, but common sense finally prevailed.
Good. Thank you, Mr. Dunwoody. You did well.
Oh. Thank you, sir. It's very heartening to see Mr. Samuel standing up so well to his recent bereavement.
Yes.
He's grown up to be quite a handsome young gentleman.
What exactly are you implying, Mr. Dunwoody?
Nothing, sir. I'm merely remarking that Mr. Samuel is a very eligible young man. As indeed you are yourself, sir. Thought Miss Charlotte was looking well, didn't you, sir?
Good night, Mr. Dunwoody.
Good night, Mr. Fraser.
I have an apology to make.
Who?
Yes, I called into the store this afternoon to see Mr. Fitch. I was right in one thing, he's an ambitious man.
Yes?
Yes, it appears he sailed for America this morning with yesterday's takings from the store.
Good heavens.
So it seems your choice of Mr. Denton was the right one after all.
Robert said it was the right choice.
What did you say, Mother?
Nothing.
I imagine Elizabeth has told you that she sees it as the end of Liverpool.
Well, she may not be that far wrong, you know.
Nonsense, it's just emotional woman's talk. I expected better of you, James. Mm. This canal will do two things. It'll increase trade by giving this country a new port, and it'll break the monopoly of the railways.
Mm. All very well if you happen to own a mill in Manchester, I suppose.
Well, why shouldn't the Enidid Line trade out of Manchester as well as Liverpool?
Because I can't tack up a canal, that's why.
Then you'd best go over to steam, James.
Well, I promised Elizabeth I'd say me piece, and I have. I'm not going to lose sleep over it. By the way, you'll have to get a bill through Parliament long before you can dig a shovelful.
And you can't see it happening?
Well, you'll come up against a lot of opposition long before it does get to Parliament. But if it ever does, then I'll put in my two pennyworth.
James, this country needs that canal.
Oh, what are you after now? Seaton House, Lord?
Oh, Daniel. Have you, ever heard of a Sir Patrick McGeary?
Oh, yes, I have. Yes, it was in the Times this morning.
That's the last one, lad. You're not expecting anyone, are you, Mr. Wadham?
What?
No, no. All in the boat, then. Hey!
Got room for a little one, Baines? I thought you said you weren't coming, sir.
Oh, I've changed my mind, haven't I?
Good morning, Charlotte. And how was Henry Irving?
Oh, marvellous, marvellous. Father not down yet?
Yeah, he's been gone for 3 hours.
Oh, where to this time?
I don't know. He said he'd be back in a few days. He's up to something, but for the life of me, I can't think what.
He didn't get in till 1 o'clock this morning, did he?
No. How do you know that?
I heard him. I was awake.
Surprising, then, that you're as bright as a button. Could be something to do with Samuel taking you to the theatre last night.
Samuel? Good heavens, no.
What, then?
Letty, there's something I must tell you about last night. When we got to the theatre, William was there. He'd taken a box and he insisted we share it with him.
That must have pleased Samuel.
Oh, Samuel can be so ungrateful. I mean, the circle is very nice, but it's not like a box, is it? And when William ordered champagne in the interval, he never so much as thanked him.
Now, wait a minute. Who brought you home?
William. In a hansom.
Then I think it just as well that your father did come home late.
Finished your chin wag with Mr. Wallen, eh?
Aye, he talks a lot, but at the end of the day he said nothing.
Hmm, where is he now?
He's admiring the view. I can't say I like it much.
I can't say I do either.
There's nothing wrong with the course, is there, sir?
No, no. You know, I reckon the wind's going to shift.
It might veer a bit, but it's a good steady blow, sir.
No, I think it'll veer quite a lot.
Well, there's no reason why it should. Do you mind telling me what you're up to, sir?
So far, nothing. I think I need to take a look in the hold.
Bit on the fresh side.
Ah, yes, I was just saying to Captain Baines here, I reckon the wind is going to change, you know. Now then, have a glass. Warm you up.
Thanks. This is our course, Captain Baines.
Aye.
Westby North.
You know something about the sea, do you, Mr. Wadden?
I was in shipping for a few years. Thanks. Not joining me, Aaron Eden?
Later.
Mr. Wadham, this bay we're going to, do you know what the holding's like?
What?
I mean, the seabed, what's it like?
I've never been there.
No, I reckon we could anchor about here. I mean, there's a fair depth of water and a good run ashore. Now, what do you say, sir?
You're the master, Captain Baines. You decide.
When you say there'll be men there, I suppose they'll be from Sir Patrick McGeary's estate.
Yes, yes.
Now there's one other thing, sir.
Worked it all out, had you?
Aye.
Hope to claim the reward, eh?
Mr. O'Needed!
Just coming up, Captain Baines! I think. Or am I wrong?
You couldn't be content with a nice fat charter fee. Oh, no, you had to poke your nose into other people's affairs.
I told you right from the start I didn't like the look of him.
No, neither did I. That's why I checked up on Sir Patrick McGeary.
There was nothing wrong with that story. I worked on that for a long time. Even down to the cove where you loaded the crates on board, that was on his estate. And it'll be the same in Ireland. Only I happen to know that the old boy and most of his staff are in London at the moment. So how did you find out?
After the robbery in Manchester, you were so obviously busy arranging things that you didn't read the newspapers properly. Or indeed the obituary notices.
Sir Patrick's dead.
Well, I'll be damned. Now that I didn't reckon on. I worked for him once, you know. Still, doesn't alter the fact that we're on our way to Ireland. And there's nothing you can do about that, O'Needan.
What happens when we get there?
Same as we arranged, Captain Baines. Once you've got those crates ashore, you can go to the devil for all I care.
And after we've been to the police, you won't get far.
Oh, I don't think he'll do that, Captain Baines. You see, I can prove that Mr. O'Needan received a very large fee for this charter. I feel sure the police would accept my word that we were all working hand in glove.
Afraid he's right, Baines.
I could lose my ticket over this.
You'd lose a damn sight more than that, Captain.
Sorry, then.
It's a fine time to be sorry.
What's happening?
It's the end of the forenoon watch, mister.
Stay where you are, Captain.
Somebody has to run the ship, you know, Mr. Wyndham.
If I don't go up there, they'll soon come down here for their orders.
He's right, you know. Well, if you don't trust Captain Baines, maybe I'd better go up there. I shall only be 2 minutes.
All right, you can go. But remember, one wrong move, and he's dead. I'm warning you, Baines.
That's right, mister. Don't you take your eyes off me. Because if you do, I'll wring your neck like a chicken.
You damn fool, get me up before I kick you there. And Baines? Mr. Willard? Home over here!
You go first. And no tricks.
And I can promise you one thing. You'll never work on one of my ships again. Just cause Baines is kind-hearted doesn't mean to say that I am. Baines, what possessed you to sign on that helmsman? The man's an idiot.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with Seth.
Over there, Captain, where I can see you. Come on. What's the trouble, O'Needan?
I told you the wind had changed, but you wouldn't listen.
I said, what's the trouble?
The wind's veered and taken us with it. He was watching the sail instead of the compass.
I don't believe you.
Look for yourself, man. Luke, east northeasterly. We're going back to England.
We should be sailing westby north.
Aye, to Ireland. If we hold that course, we'll damn near finish up where we started from.
O'Needan, if this is some kind of trick.
Oh, Luke, man. I've no wish to be caught with your stolen goods aboard my ship any more than you do.
Very well. Alter course.
All hands, stand by to go about.
We'll just shut out the outside world. You're not frightened, are you, Sarah?
No.
Good. Now, I must tell you this. Whatever happens, do not leave the table.
Mr. Pilgrim, should my eyes be open or closed?
As you wish. Tell me, do you have anything that Robert gave you some time ago? A piece of jewelry? Something that means a good deal to both of you?
My wedding ring.
There's no need. Did you know that the power to see lies dormant in you, Sarah?
Me?
Oh, yes. It's quite strong. Robert has been with me since you entered the room. He's very, very close.
Yes, Robert. Yes. Pigs. Taking them to market. Yes, she hears, Robert. I see candles. Lots of candles. Do they mean anything to you, Sarah?
Yes. Yes, in the shop.
And now I see another shop. Much bigger. Money. A man taking... No, no, no. A man stealing money.
That's right.
Robert saying, all for the good. Dentist? No. Den was a better choice. I don't understand.
Mr. Denton.
An older man.
Yes.
Ah, yes. Robert is very pleased with this man. My throat. Difficult breathing.
No, Robert.
Says not your fault. He'll wait for you. He's getting fainter, Sarah. He's leaving us.
Don't go, Robert. Ah, don't go.
A voice. A woman's voice. No, no. A girl. Slowly. Slowly. Murray. Slowly. Murray. Slow. Maritza. Ah, yes. Maritza. She knows you, Sarah. She is with Robert. And? Ah, yes, your hand is better. She's gone. Perhaps it was someone you knew a long time ago. But the rest had meaning for you, Sarah?
Yes. Oh, yes. Mr. Pilgrim, you've been such a comfort.
I am merely the instrument.
To speak with Robert. Please, may I come again?
Of course. Though others will not want you to.
Then it shall be our secret. Mr. Pilgrim, you have helped me so much. Please let me help you.
In what way?
A contribution.
It is not necessary.
Oh, but I insist.
Very well, Sarah. As you can afford it, I will allow you to donate the maximum contribution. 5 shillings.
You sure this is the place?
Next bay along. Better fly the red pendant and the V, Captain Baines.
Aye, sir. Just a moment. What's going on?
We're going to fly the customary flags. There could be excise men up there. It's all normal procedure.
Are you sure?
Only draw attention to ourselves if we don't.
Very well.
Hoist BV.
Right, Captain Baines. Let's get those crates ready. The sooner you're off my ship, the better I like it.
No.
What do you think? Who's going to put it on the rocks?
I wouldn't put it past him. Let the crew unload.
Samuel, you are home early.
Yes, I didn't feel much like work.
Something's wrong.
Oh, I've had a letter. Rather upset me. I don't suppose you remember her. It was a long time ago. She was Polish, a lace maker. She came to the store.
Yes, I do remember vaguely. But didn't she go to America?
Aye, that's right, with her brother, Stepan. On the way over, there was a storm. Her hand was crushed.
Her name was Maritza.
Oh, then you do remember her. I grew very fond of her. But I'm afraid Steppen has written to say that she was recently killed in a street accident in New York.
There's no sign of my men, O'Needham. If you brought me to the wrong cove...
You saw the chart yourself.
From out there, they all look alike.
Perhaps these are your men. Well, I did warn you not to take your eyes off me.
Officer.
Thank you, sir. Right then, gentlemen, explanations are in order.
In those cases, I think you'll find the treasure from the Manchester robbery.
Had a clean mole.
Come on your feet!
Well, first thing first. Your name, sir?
You're Welsh.
With a name like Llewellyn, what do you expect?
You got me signal then, eh?
We got a signal that you are discharging dangerous cargo.
There's your dangerous cargo. Name of Wadham.
But we were sailing west.
Must have been something wrong with the compass.
Damn lucky we didn't end up in Iceland.
Rubbish.
Good navigation, that's all.
£5,000 you'll pick up for this night's work, sir.
Aye. Buy me a new ship.